Welcome, everyone, to the heart of the North Georgia Mountains at Haynes and Carolyn Hill Stadium in Dahlonega, Georgia.
Overtime and overdue.
It is gone!
That is
Georgia Blair, a three-run bomb in the bottom of the seventh, ties this up.
Make my night up on the moon. In the morning, get the news.
The center field in North Georgia is going to walk it off. Mary Seal Barumbi seals the deal for North Georgia.
Take one down and hit my peak.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Haynes and Carolyn Hill Stadium here in Lynn Cottrell Park for Senior Day 2024 edition for the University of North Georgia Nighthawks softball team, a team that just yesterday clinched its 10th consecutive regular season Peach Belt Conference Tournament title. Alongside myself, Brennan Shabath, is my partner, Robert DiClemente. And with that, Robert, because of the clinch yesterday, on Senior Day today, head coach Mike Davenport gets to do something really cool. He gets to start. It works out perfectly. There's 10 seniors on this roster this year. All 10 are going to get to start today.
Yeah, this is just such a great sight to see, you know, seniors in positions that they typically wouldn't play in a normal game. We got a couple seniors, you know, Delaney Heberlin at short. We got Kristen Davis over at second to start this game out. And, you know, it's such a fun sight to see here.
Yeah, so as we take a look at the UNG starting field today, Wicker in left because the senior Simmons plays in right where Wicker typically would. Mallory Parker's in her usual spot. Gracie Mixon and Sophie Mooney on the corners defensively. And then the pitchers, Kristen Davis at second base and Delaney Heberlin at shortstop, backing up the senior pitcher and ace, Tybee Denton, for the Nighthawks as Georgia Blair has the duties behind the dish. We are underway, strike one at 12:56 on Senior Day. Always a fun, festive day, and I think there's a lot of relief for this Nighthawk team. After the scare in game one yesterday, a 12-3 run rule loss, as that ball's belted deep and way out but foul. A 12-3 run rule loss yesterday, their first home run rule loss since 2014. All that kind of anxiety that came with that and just the shock of it went out the window when they were able to seal the win in game two, seal the regular season. And today, you want to pick up a win, obviously. You want to do some things right, but you also get to have fun and celebrate your seniors.
Absolutely. I think this is setting up a great series finale between these two squads because, you know, that game one, Georgia College did something that very few teams have done before in program history against North Georgia, taking them down in five innings here in game number one. And then game two, we saw North Georgia dominate for most of that game, even though Georgia College, you know, they tried here and there to climb back into that one and make it competitive. North Georgia won rather easily, and so I think that's setting up a fantastic series finale between two, you know, really great offenses this afternoon.
It's two balls and two strikes on the leadoff hitter Emily Hobbs for Georgia College, and she bounces out to Mixon over at third. And with that, we'll take a look at the Georgia College batting lineup here in the top of the first. Hobbs, the shortstop, leads it off. Davina Checo, a few spots ahead of her sister Reyna Checo, both at second and third base, respectively, defensively. The freshman Carly Gutierrez with a big day yesterday. She'll bat third. Owens in fourth, Conlin in fifth, and then three lefties round out the lineup and the outfield. Caroline Pollock, Mackenzie Martin, and Eliza Kuhn as Denton throws a first pitch ball to Davina Checo with one down. Up above the zone, two balls and no strikes. So really cool of Mike Davenport. I think he was probably pretty excited that he had 10 seniors today and he could start all 10 of them. We'll get to see. I don't foresee Kristen Davis and Delaney Heberlin remaining in the defensive infield for very long in this game, especially if things get out of hand. But we'll see how he handles the lineup the rest of the way. Obviously, all 10 of these seniors have contributed in their careers to the success of this North Georgia program and can do good things for this team. I'm just not sure that's the pitchers on offense, as Denton allows a four-pitch walk in the second at-bat of the game to Davina Checo.
And to just show you the veteran, you know, leadership on this squad, the only two players that are playing, you know, quote-unquote out of position are Davis and Heberlin. All these other positions are, you know, typically occupied by seniors.
Right, absolutely. We'll be interesting to see what he does with Sophie Mooney over at first base. I think the expectation is that every senior is going to get an at-bat. Even the pitchers, I think that'd be pretty cool for them to get an at-bat. We'll see what happens once we get to that point in the game. But for Sophie Mooney, who has been dealing a little bit of some injury bugs, she is good to go, but talking to her today, she's not quite 100%. She's expecting to maybe be there by the end of the regular season. Only four games left, so really not that far ahead when you look at it. That one's fouled right back down on top of home plate.
And I think that
Carly Gutierrez.
That win yesterday in game two for North Georgia, like you said, they clinched the PBC regular season title. And so I think that gives, you know, Sophie Mooney a little bit more leeway if she wants to, you know, rest a little bit more before the tournament starts for North Georgia. And so that was just a big win for them.
Nice back pick from Blair to first. It's unsuccessful, though. We've got it as 1-2 on the scoreboard. I believe it's two balls and two strikes with that last pitch. Grounded to third and foul ball. Gutierrez had a big day yesterday. Really quiet in game two, actually. Held to just 1-for-2 with a walk. But game one was a couple loud swings for the freshman.
Yeah, I'd say that game two from her was solid, just quiet compared to the, you know, career day she had in game one with those seven RBIs. That was just, you know, an incredible performance for her, a couple of three-run bombs.
Yeah, I guess that's not really fair to say she had a quiet day in game two. She got on base twice out of the four times she went to the plate. She just didn't hit two home runs. So still 1-2 the count. And Gutierrez just staying alive here. A couple foul balls in this two-strike count.
Yeah, just like yesterday, this is going to be the matchup to watch here with, you know, Tybee Denton got the start in game two. And, you know, she held, like we said, Gutierrez quiet-ish in game number two. And so here in this series finale, still the matchup to watch between two PBC players of the week.
Roped but foul. Gutierrez still going by my count. Nine pitches will commence in this at-bat with the next one from Denton. I'd like to note for the record, I was correct. The scoreboard has been updated to two balls and two strikes. And another foul ball by Gutierrez. The senior day festivities today will take place after the game. The Nighthawks will let Georgia College depart and get back on the road to Milledgeville. And then they will begin the process of celebrating those 10 seniors. Possible double play ball. Mixon is not going to go to second. She'll just get Gutierrez at first. So the first two outs in the inning go 5-3 as Checo moves into scoring position with two down. Brings up Jessica Owens, the first baseman today.
Number 24, Jessica Owens.
Yeah, Owens had that hit in game one for Georgia College. A couple RBIs attached to it. Didn't have anything going in game two, so she's looking to bounce back here.
Owens, the most starts of anybody on this Georgia College roster this year, all 47 games. She pops this one up on the left side. Does Mixon have room? No, that's going to get into the dugout of the Bobcats over on the third base side, so it's 1-1. Owens hitting 358, five bombs on the year. 35 RBIs. Second on the team. It's only a few behind Carly Gutierrez, who has 55.
Oh, man.
As a freshman. I mean, that's just unbelievable stuff.
Yeah, like we said yesterday, she has surpassed PBC Freshman of the Week, and she's now since moved on to PBC just overall Player of the Week honors.
Yeah, it's very rare, just given that the way the Peach Belt does it, because as a school, if you've got the chance to nominate a player and a freshman separately, you would just nominate two in the hopes that maybe you get two. But she has played well enough to earn Player of the Week accolades, and she's certainly on the short list for Freshman of the Year accolades. She showed why yesterday.
Yeah, and with the talent that we have in the Peach Belt Conference, you know, to earn that award as a freshman, that is, it's pretty great.
It's a bit of a longer first inning so far for Denton. Couple of long at-bats. This is the second three-ball count as it's full on Owens. It's that one in on the barrel. Foul. Wicker sliding over to the corner, but unsuccessfully, despite a good effort. I'd like to see one get hit up the middle, not up the middle, but to one of the middle infielders here. See if Davis and Heberlin can make a play before they likely depart in this game. The 3-2 again. Just foul tipped. Kind of reminds me, I had the pleasure of working with the Detroit Tigers last season over the summer as an intern there. And from those that are around baseball, know it was Miguel Cabrera's last season, the historic Hall of Famer, and Miguel Cabrera hasn't played defense in the last 3 or 4 years. You know, he's just been a DH. But in his last home game, they didn't quite get the at-bat he wanted, so they put him in defensively, and on the first at-bat, the ball was grounded right to him, and he got to make a play, which was pretty cool. Just a little nubber from Owens. I think they'll say it was foul off her foot. I thought it was fair at first, but everybody's returning back to their starting positions. But I kind of think of that here with Davis and Heberlin. Your last home game of your career, you get to start in the infield defensively. You kind of want a ball hit at you, I would assume.
Yeah, you know, it's just show what you're made of at these new positions.
On the ground, Heberlin can't get there. It's out into left center field. This will score a run. Checo comes home. Owens slides into second. And the Bobcats are on the board first. Well, I guess we got what we asked for, huh?
Yeah. I mean, that was going to be a tough play to make regardless of who was at that position at that time. But, yeah, like we said yesterday, GCSU does not struggle with getting their hits. One of the best teams in the nation in that category.
So another RBI for Owens. Been impressed already early in this game with the level of these at-bats. Gutierrez had a long one. Checo stayed disciplined on a four-pitch walk. Owens stood in the box forever in that last one on a 3-2 with a couple foul balls and was able to get the knock. Now it's Stephanie Conlin, the designated player today. Ball and a strike from Denton. In there, bottom of the zone, strike two. So the last home game for the Nighthawks, but not the last broadcast that we will have here on the Nighthawk Sports Network, as the Peach Belt Tournament and we hope the NCAA Southeast Regional are on their way to Dahlonega here in just a couple weeks.
That's become a tradition here to host the PBC Tournament games at Haynes and Carolyn Hill.
Strike three called. Conlin goes down looking. Denton gives up a run but gets out of the inning with her first K of the day. And the seniors are going to bat next on the Nighthawk Sports Network.
To them, the whole world looks like an opportunity. One to be seized, built upon, and made better for their sport and the people around it. To student athletes, every opportunity is a chance to change what could be and show the world what opportunity can do.
Back here in the Nighthawk Sports Network, Mr. Blue Sky playing in between innings, and pretty fitting because it is just a gorgeous day for softball today, Robert. 76 degrees, a light breeze, clear blue skies above Dahlonega today, and a perfect day to celebrate Senior Day as Madison Simmons, the senior right fielder, will lead things off for the Nighthawks. Going against Tiffany Caban, the pitcher today, for the Bobcats. Caban throws a first pitch ball outside.
Okay, couldn't ask for better weather here to set up this series finale. Sky matching the baby blue unis North Georgia's got on today.
Simmons skies it to the left side. The shortstop Hobbs backs up and makes the catch. With that, we'll take a look at the Nighthawk lineup here on Senior Day. So you've got Simmons leading it off. Parker will follow. Blair in her three hole. Mooney with a little bit of pop cleans things up. Wicker will bat fifth. Mixon over at third base will bat sixth. And then Aniston Wright, Delaney Heberlin, and Kristen Davis, the 7, 8, and 9 hitters. Aniston Wright, the senior pitcher, as the designated player today. I don't know that I've ever been more excited to see the bottom of the order come up in any given game than today.
Oh, absolutely. I am so curious and so excited to see what we're going to get at bat from some of our seniors here.
So looking at the stats from this season, Aniston Wright is the only pitcher that has any semblance of a track record at the plate. She's 1-for-5 this year. Did have an RBI on her only hit.
I believe she played in that Columbus State series a little bit.
So Mallory Parker quickly 3 balls and no strikes and in a good spot to maybe move this inning down to that bottom of the order.
And this is a senior that is so used to being in the batter's box for North Georgia, one of the best hitters on this North Georgia squad for quite a few years now. And like we mentioned before, she missed pretty much all of last season due to an injury. She played in only 7 games, but she was batting over .500. She was killing it in those 7 games. So it's been great to see her bounce back here in her senior season.
And she takes ball 4 here. Parker hitting .360 this season. Almost 30 RBIs, .474 on base percentage. Just backing up some of those statements that you made there, Robert, one of the best hitters this year for the Nighthawks. So the first inning starts the same for each of these starting pitchers, Caban and Denton. A first at-bat out and then a walk in the second at-bat. That brings up Georgia Blair. First pitch strike, nice fastball there from Caban. Tiffany Caban, a freshman out of Evans, Georgia. 5'6 stands the righty. And there's a slider. He's darting back into the zone for a strike two, and the freshman is ahead on Georgia Blair.
And Blair is such an integral part to this team's success, even with the hitting power of, you know, Mooney and Lester. It's Georgia Blair who leads this team in home runs and RBIs this season, and hits, I believe, as well.
Blair, high fly ball, but foul down the third base side. Just catching up to that fastball. Keeps it 0-2. So I was mistaken earlier when I mentioned, or no, I was correct. Delaney Heberlin does not have an at-bat this year. She has one from last year. So she'll get her second career at-bat, most likely at some point in this game. The 0-2 to Blair, up and away. for Davis. The hitting stats are essentially non-existent the last 2 years. She did get two at-bats back in 2022 and struck out twice.
There's first time for everything.
Absolutely. No better day to get your first hit. Heck, just get on base in any capacity than on senior day.
We've got a great crowd on hand this afternoon, too. Lots of fans out there in the terrace.
Well, like we were talking, I mean, who wouldn't want to come watch softball today? I mean, what a gorgeous day today is. So Blair's worked it back to a 2-2. And she's worked it full, running on the pitch. Parker, that's out into center field. Mallory will stay right at second base, though. So a stolen bag for Parker. That's her fourth of the season.
And this is what we've become accustomed to seeing from this North Georgia squad this season. You get on base, you steal a base, and then you rope a double to score someone.
Love a double here. From 0-2 to 3-2. Blair swings and pops it foul back over the grandstands. She'll try again. Georgia with a team best 42 RBIs this season. Also leads the team with 91 total bases, 20 more than second place. All that extra base power. And she's not going to get to show it here. What an at-bat, though, from Georgia Blair. Forcing Caban to nibble around the edges. She didn't get much of a meal with back-to-back walks.
And Sophie Mooney, while she may be dealing with a hamstring injury right now, she's still not a player that any team wants to
see. You don't want to see her come up to the plate. It don't matter what. One hamstring, two hamstrings, no hamstrings. The All-American is an imposing threat in that right-handed batter's box, and that first pitch a sign of respect from Caban as she stays well away from the bat on the outside for ball one. The light breeze today is coming in from right field from the parking lot. Not quite foul pole to foul pole. Mooney, high fly ball, deep left, a rocket home run! Sophie Mooney! What a start to this game! And she will take her time around the bases.
As she should. My goodness. She missed the last couple of games. Doesn't matter. No rust at all from Sophie Mooney. And what a great sight to see here on senior day. Mooney roping a three-run bomb to left.
What an awesome moment. I mean, she is very clearly, as she has said, just not 100% with that leg injury that she's dealing with. And still, like we just mentioned, you don't want to see her step up to the plate. And two pitches later, bang, she proves just why and gives the Nighthawks the lead early here, 3-1.
When she comes back healthy for the PBC tournament, that's going to be...
Look out.
Yeah.
I think maybe as a perhaps mistake on our part in the conversation we had yesterday, for anybody that joined us for the doubleheader, one, we appreciate it, two, you'll remember this, is that we talked a lot about the expectations of the national championship season a year ago and how that plays into this year. And this year, I don't want to say they haven't lived up to the expectations, but just a couple struggles, especially as of late, and obviously in game one yesterday. And we talked about some of the injuries, and we didn't really touch on just how big of a deal it is to not have Sophie Mooney in the lineup. And you see it today, proof positive in one swing, just the impact that she can have.
I mean, it's crazy to see how good this team has been, too, without Mooney and Lester in the starting lineup. Because normally when you lose, you know, your two most powerful hitters, you know, you take a pretty significant drop-off in play. And, you know, while this team has had to go through some adjustment periods over the last couple weeks, you know, Lester out for the season, Mooney, you know, out for probably the last handful of games here in the regular season, they've still treaded water very, very nicely.
Mariah Wicker, senior outfielder, works a walk, the third of the inning for the freshman Tiffany Caban. And As she lets it get away a little bit, there's going to be a visit in the circle. So Gracie Mixon will come up to bat next. Just touching on Mooney and her absence of late. Missed a few games early in the year. I want to say it was early March. But before today, that Columbus State series, the doubleheader in day one, that was when she suffered that injury, and she hasn't played since then. So this is her first game since April 6th. And in that time, the Nighthawks have played almost 10 games. So the visit is over in the circle, and Mixon is ready for her first plate appearance of the day.
Number 15, Tracy Mixon.
Mixon takes ball one. Gracie, the senior from Canton, Georgia, Cherokee High School, on the season, hitting .311. Robert, you mentioned yesterday how she's the Iron Man, sort of, in this Nighthawk lineup. 47 games the Nighthawks have played. Gracie has started in all of them. That's the most of any player on this roster.
Yeah, she started every game last season for North Georgia as well. She's just the epitome of consistency. And from 2021, North Georgia, they played 237. This is now their 237th, yes, 237th game. And Mixon's been there for all 4 years. If you had to guess how many games Mixon has missed, what would
and
you say?
237.
It's a single digit.
Yeah. That's I figured that with the question. I'm going to say in 4 years, in 237 games, Gracie Mixon has missed two.
She's missed five.
Wow.
But
that's still,
that,
I mean, unbelievably impressive.
And you know, you don't like, I don't know the reason behind missing some of those games. It could just
how
be
dare she?
For rest, right? Yeah, how dare you miss five games out of, you know,
over nearly
200 plus.
Oh, yeah. Wicker going on the pitch. It's ball four anyways. Fourth walk, and the bullpen now busy for the Bobcats, and head coach Kenneth Bellamy is going to have to think about it. I think he is going to the bullpen. He sure is. So we'll step aside for a quick pitching change. Sophie Mooney with a big swing. Nighthawks not done yet. They're up 3-1 with a pair of runners on here on Senior Day on the Nighthawk Sports Network.
To them, the whole world looks like an opportunity, one to be seized, built upon, and made better for their sport and the people around it. To student athletes, every opportunity is a chance to change what could be and show the world what opportunity can do.
Jonna Shellhorse takes over in the circle, going against the pitcher for the Nighthawks, Aniston Wright. Robert, we got our wish. The bottom of the order, starting with the seven-hole hitter, Aniston Wright, does get to come to bat here in this first inning.
I think it definitely helps with that cushion from Sophie Mooney's three-run bomb.
And Aniston Wright is going to reach on a hit by pitch. The first pitcher is on. Heberlin is now up. Loads the bases for her as well.
Yeah, it's not only is she going to get a chance to potentially get her first hit, but also have an RBI attached to it too.
First pitch, Heberlin takes for a strike up in the zone. It's a good take from the Eustis, Florida native.
Imagine if we just saw first pitch, lets it fly.
He just ropes it.
The terrace.
And she takes strike two. Shellhorse out of the bullpen, obviously wanting to throw strikes, but also maybe going at the pitchers a little bit more. She did get a little wild against Aniston Wright, leading to the hit batter. Now 0-2. Curveball up, and Heberlin lays off. Shellhorse, a senior herself out of McDonough, Georgia. Saw her yesterday start game two for the Bobcats.
Statistically, Ben, the best pitcher on this Bobcat squad.
The 1-2. Heberlin swings and misses at the off speed. So a strikeout for Shellhorse. And Kristen Davis will not get to bat. Mary Seal Brumby will pinch hit for her. So Davis got to get work in the infield. Didn't have anything hit to her. Delaney Heberlin at shortstop had the busy day. She had the ball hit her way and then gets the at-bat here.
She's had a busy last few days or so. Came in that game two against Alabama Huntsville. Did a great job in the circle for North Georgia to close that one out, ultimately leading to that comeback win in the bottom of the seventh for North Georgia.
Brumby had a home run yesterday in game one, had an RBI double in game two. Part of our conversation yesterday was about how much she's taken advantage of her newfound playing time after the injuries to Mooney.
Yeah, she's worked her way into this lineup quite nicely for North Georgia, taking advantage of any opportunity she can get, and it's definitely paid off.
On the ground, first base side, and down fair. Wicker scores. Coming around is Mixon. Wright gets the stop sign at third. Mary Seal Brumby does it again. A two-run double down the line. It's 5-1 here in the first.
Yeah, Mary Seal bringing a lot of momentum into this weekend. After that walk-off win, she had the walk-off base hit against Alabama Huntsville, and you know, she's been great in this series for North Georgia.
So Wicker and Mixon, the two that walked from the starter Caban, do score. So Tiffany Caban's day ends with a third of an inning, one hit, and five runs. The one hit, obviously, Sophie Mooney's three-run blast. And that one's off the leg of Simmons as she bats for the second time here in the first. She popped up in the first at-bat. Here she reaches to load the bases again with two outs for Mallory Parker.
This is slightly reminiscent of what we saw in yesterday's game one, except it was flipped. It was Georgia College who out the gates was, you know, smoking hot in that game one. And you know, here in this series finale, North Georgia proving why they got some of the best bats in Division II softball.
Yeah, just a complete flip of the script from game one yesterday. Only two hits in the inning for the Nighthawks. Mooney's home run and Brumby's double. The rest have been walks and hit batters. Four walks in total, two hit batters. Parker was one of those walks. All the way back in the very beginning of this inning, which itself feels like a few innings ago.
Yeah, this first inning has dragged on a bit, but for all the right reasons.
Hey,
when
the Blue are batting, it can drag on all day.
Oh, yeah. We'll go till 10 o'clock at night if we need to.
Parker with two outs and the bases juiced, facing the 1-2. She takes ball two outside. Mallory, one of three lefties today, originally started as just two, but Brumby, the pinch hitter for Davis, batting from the left side. The 2-2, swing and a miss. Strike three as Parker goes down. Shellhorse gets two Ks for the two outs she needed to get out of the first, but the damage was done from Mooney and Brumby. A three-run blast from the senior, a two-run double from the sophomore, and a four-run lead for the Nighthawks after one on the Nighthawks Sports Network. We'll be right back.
have a long tradition of athletics at the University of North Georgia. For the past 50 years, our athletic programs have been making a difference for our university. And today, I'm really excited to talk about how we will take that to the next level. When you think about elite athletics, you think about elite performance. Mary Robb, tell me what that means to you.
So elite performance at the University of North Georgia is unique because we have a value proposition unlike anybody else in this country, where we're able to perform at the highest level because of our connections with our Corps of Cadets and our College of Health Sciences and Professions, coupled with our professionals from coaches, athletic trainers, support staff, and our Department of Athletics. But we're preparing our student athletes to battle on the field of competition, in the classroom, and in our community. We'll be elite in everything we do.
So today, we are really excited to announce our strategic bet, where we are going to deliver elite performance, elite competition, and the most value-adding Division II athletic program in America. Go Nighthawks!
Back on the Nighthawk Sports Network for inning number two, and we've got the expected defensive changes for you after the senior pitchers get the start in the infield. Riley Moody, the junior transfer, takes over at short. Katie Ward, the sophomore second baseman, is right at second base. And Mary Seal Brumby, after her pinch hit two-run double for Kristen Davis, is over at first in place of Sophie Mooney. I think that went almost exactly as Mike Davenport probably would have wanted.
Oh, yeah, you couldn't have asked for a better start to this game. You know, you get out of that top half of the inning just letting the Bobcats put one run up on the board, and then, you know, your seniors get to see action up to bat there in the bottom of the first. Sophie Mooney showing no rust, hitting that three-run bomb. Her day is probably done, so she can, you know, I think she's proven that, you know. Well, she's proven all she can here in this, in her only at-bat.
So Denton falling behind in this first at-bat. Three balls and no strikes to Reyna Checo and a four-pitch walk. Already the second of the day for Tybee. Maybe a little fatigue setting in from yesterday. She pitched well in game two, but did give up five runs, and it was a little bit of a longer game. But, yeah, having that moment for Mooney, I think, is exactly what he was probably looking for in starting all 10 seniors. Just one marquee cool moment for one of them. And for Mooney to get to do that was pretty awesome. And now it's about, you know, two of them are pitchers. We talked about some of the pitching woes yesterday. Now it's about, okay, you got your moment. Get out of the lineup. Go bubble wrap yourself in the dugout. Stay healthy, because the important stuff is coming up with the final regular season series, Peach Belt Tournament, and then the NCAA Tournament not too long after that.
You definitely want to be 100% healthy, or as healthy as you can, heading into tournament play and NCAA play later on down the line.
So Pollock ahead, two balls and a strike. A lot of these hitters through the first seven batters have been in front of Tybee Denton. Pollock rifles one back over the screen our way. We're perched on the left side of the press box here at Haynes and Carolyn Hill Stadium. It's a three-room press box. It's not all connected as one. There's the middle room that has four windows and a couple of different seats where the scoreboard operates, PA, stats, all that stuff. And the right press box, which is separate, two windows and two seats, is usually where the social media and photographers go. And then they just throw us broadcasters over here on the left.
That's pretty cozy in here, though, I will say.
I will say the air conditioner works here in the left one. It doesn't work for the social people in the right one. So I know they're feeling it today. It is a little toasty over there. Nighthawk faithful not happy with that call. Thought they had strike three on Caroline Pollock. Instead, it's ball three, which is the fourth three-ball count that Denton has faced through the first seven batters already. The 3-2 up and in for ball four, and Tybee Denton with a shoulder shrug and a raise of the arm can't understand just where that pitch missed, and I happen to agree with her.
And we mentioned yesterday, you know, Tybee, her walks this season is probably at a number where, you know, according to her standards, probably not where she wants it exactly, but, you know, when you're one of the leaders in the nation in strikeouts, she has almost 100 more strikeouts than she does walks this season. It kind of buries that stat a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely. You always look at oftentimes when you see a pitcher with high walks, it's also high strikeouts, but it's not like top 10 in the nation high like Tybee Denton
right.
is. She blows it out of the water. Typically, those two numbers just tend to stay correlated. If it's low walks, it's also low strikeouts, a little bit more control, a little bit more pitch to contact. For Tybee, it's almost all or nothing. Swing and miss down with a strikeout or a walk in some capacity. Popped up. Thought that was coming. That was right over our heads. Thought we might have had a chance in the conversation yesterday, reach out and catch a foul ball.
I could have made a play on it there. That one may have domed the press box.
Right to second, back to second base, and safely sliding back was Checo on the line out to Katie Ward. And Katie Ward can't believe it either that that wasn't an out.
Brumby's going to give her the infield here some high fives. I think she knows that in her heart what that play could have been.
Mike Davenport pleading his case. I thought live she was out. Double play would be big to essentially nix the two walks that started the inning. I don't know that they will change this call, though. If they did, I would say it's one of the first times and only times I've seen that this year, and they're going to keep her there and say she's safe. So Checo at second, Pollock at first. Martin lines out, bringing up the nine-hole hitter, Eliza Kuhn.
I think that just kind of goes to show, you know, how good Brumby is for, I'd say, the spirit of this team. And she's, you know, was a great dugout player last season, and she's done a lot of damage on the field this year. But to keep the team's spirits up after, you know, a play like that kind of, you know, could be frustrating to Katie Ward, just speaks to the leadership that she provides to this team.
Well, there's also a sentiment of look good, play good, and there's a new development with Mary Seal and this softball team this year.
Yes.
I may be butchering the name. I believe it's called Hair by Seal, and she's the one taking the pride in braiding her teammates' hairs in different styles and patterns and showing them off on social media, and it's become a fun little thing for them at the end of this season. You might have more knowledge on it than I do, but I know today, pregame, some parents were here early for senior day, and Mary Seal brought all of her clients, if you will, over to behind home plate in front of the screen and turned them all around to show off the hair that she did to the parents, and it was just a funny moment. You know, some of the parents were jabbing her for it and stuff like that. But just like we talked about yesterday, the overarching theme is that she's really good for this locker room and someone that this team really enjoys having around. And, hey, she's playing pretty good softball too.
Yeah, I think it's like hair dot by underscore seal, something like that. Something
so hair by seal lines. Was correct, though.
Yes,
okay.
Yes, you were in the right ballpark.
Right.
Yeah, she's just become a bit of a phenomenon here over the past handful of games. And, you know, if you're going to use one word to describe Mary Seal Brumby, just fun.
Yeah,
she's just
absolutely.
A fun player, a fun person.
She fields the grounder here, has no play as second base was unattended. Ward was backing Brumby up at first. Moody was backing up a possible throw at third. So they will get just one out. The lineup flips over to Emily Hobbs.
She's also doing a Golden Nighthawk Award gala hair, if anybody's interested.
Ah, and the other athletes. Okay. First pitch to Emily Hobbs, who grounded out her first time back in the first, is low, ball one. That one's outside, two balls, no strikes. That ball is roped down the line, but foul off the bat of Hobbs. out in the center, softly charging Parker. She makes the grab for out number three. And Tybee Denton gets out of the second inning despite a couple leadoff walks. It's still 5-1 here in the Nighthawk Sports Network. Back here on the Nighthawk Sports Network for the bottom of the second inning, which is brought to you today by JSR Heating and Cooling. North Georgia Softball would like to thank one of their season sponsors, JSR Heating and Cooling, a family-owned and operated HVAC company specializing in heating, cooling, and air purification of residential and commercial businesses. JSR Heating and Cooling is a proud sponsor of Nighthawk Softball. So it's Blair at the dish to get us started in the second frame after a five-run first inning for the Nighthawks. The 1-1 to Georgia Blair coming from Jonna Shellhorse. Blair, a high fly ball deep into left center field. That one's back. Light Tower power for Georgia Blair. Nearly kissing the lights out in left. She blasts her 11th home run of the season.
And Georgia Blair sending a gift to the fans over there in the terrace in left field. What a way to start this second inning.
The two power seniors in this lineup, Georgia Blair and Sophie Mooney, with a pair of home runs today, and now Sophie Mooney steps back up to the plate. So with the defensive substitutions that we saw earlier, with Brumby taking over for Mooney at first, that means Mooney has switched to the designated player in the lineup. And we'll see if Jonna Shellhorse has any better luck. She does on the first pitch. It's strike one to Mooney. Anytime Blair steps up to the plate, you know there's a chance of that happening. And she just was all over that pitch.
Yeah, that was another one of those no doubters from Georgia Blair where, you know, the left and center fielders take a couple steps and then they're just like, eh, forget about
it. And those are courtesy steps to your pitcher. Not like just you don't want to be rude to your pitcher, but you know right away that ball is gone as Mooney grounds out to shortstop. So the solo shot from Georgia makes it 6-1, and Mariah Wicker is going to step up now.
And we didn't really get to talk about Mariah Wicker on her first at-bat, but she's just a player that everybody wants to root for, whether you're a fan of North Georgia or not. She just has an infectious positive attitude that runs deep through this team. You know, she's killing it, whether she's up to bat or she's, you know, getting the lineups from Coach Dallow at the beginning of the game and waving to the fans here at Haynes and Carolyn Hill. Does that on the road, too, for any of the fans that travel on the road for North Georgia. And, you know, she just has just such a great positive attitude.
The one word we had for fun, or for fun, the one word we had for Brumby to describe her was fun. I think if we had to pick two words to describe Mariah Wicker, because I don't think it's fair to do it with just one, it would be just genuinely kind. Like,
yes.
She's just that happy-go-lucky, just always in a good mood, always has something nice to say, will give you a nice smile, a great leader for this Nighthawk team. And she has gone through some struggles this season, both in the field and at the plate, kind of at separate times. And through it all, she has, from our vantage point, had a very good attitude about this whole situation and has worked hard to try to right any wrongs that she may have gone through this season. And she was a key piece for them in the Natty run last year. She's a key piece in what we hope to be another Natty run this year.
Yeah, she's always playing with a smile on her face. You know, even if she's, you know, comes up on the losing end of some plays, always plays with, you know, great vibes.
And she always does that. She always hustles. Every ground ball off of the bat of Mariah Wicker is close at first base. We've seen her bunt for a single dozens and dozens of times this year and in her career. And she grounds out to third for the second out here in the third. Sorry, here in the second. My scorebook got messed up because they batted around with 11 hitters in that first inning. So Mixon, who walked and scored last inning, is now back up on a 1-0. She takes strike one.
And Mixon, while her numbers won't necessarily blow you away necessarily, I mean, she's still a heck of a player, but she is just, like we said, the epitome of consistency, always makes the right play, you know, 100 times out of 100, whether she's up to bat or she's at third on top of bunts, you know, making some great catches in foul territory. She's constantly, you know, putting her body on the line and making some highlight plays for North Georgia.
Well, also to add on to the conversation that we had the last time we spoke about her, is there's a lot of privilege and just ease of your mind and stress as the head coach and Mike Davenport when you know Gracie Mixon's got third base. Every single day she's there, she's got third base, she's got a spot in the middle of the order. Maybe her spot moves based on other people you're trying to move around, but she is not going to make you change herself in the lineup very much. And because of that consistency, that's probably one of the things a coach loves the most from any player. You don't want to go into a game wondering what player you're going to get today, and you never have that question with Gracie Mixon.
Absolutely not. She's the same player, you know, day in and day out, and she's held down that third base position for North Georgia for ever now, it seems like.
And now she's got two walks today in her first two plate appearances. That's the first walk allowed by Shellhorst, and she came on after six batters in the first. Brings up Katie Ward in her first at-bat. This would have been Aniston Wright, but with Mooney taking over as the DP right now done for the day. As we expected, the 7, 8, and 9 pitchers, the seniors in the starting lineup would be.
And Ward, you know, only a sophomore, but she plays like a senior. She's this, you know, this year she's playing like she's a veteran out there for North Georgia. And she, in her increased role here in her second season at UNG, she has been phenomenal. And she's definitely earned that, you know, being etched into the top of the batting order, I should say.
Oh, yeah, you would never have guessed she was a sophomore. Not at all. And the way her power has come to life this year, like we talked about yesterday, is another reason for that, and a reason that she has moved up and up in the lineup. She led off both games yesterday, obviously not getting to today with it being senior day. Just stays alive there on what looked like a changeup on the 1-2 count. One ball and two strikes. Ward swings, and it's a high fly ball sharply out into center, but playable for Eliza Kuhn. Good strike from Ward, maybe just off the end of the barrel a little bit as it sliced away towards right center for out number three. Nighthawks do get another run thanks to Georgia Blair and a solo shot, her 11th of the season. It's 6-1 on the Nighthawks Sports Network.
Awesome. If you could buy your next vehicle without going to the dealership, now you can with Beaver Direct. It's fast and really simple. Log into BeaverToyotaOfCumming.com, click on Beaver Direct, quietly shop from hundreds of vehicles, obtain a credit approval and trade appraisal in minutes.
Northeast Georgia Health System is a proud supporter of North Georgia Nighthawk Athletics.
The road to national championships runs through NCAA.com. And whether you follow one college team or all of them, it's never been easier to get the content you want with NCAA.com, the home of college sports.
River City Bank is today's second inning sponsor as we are onto the third. And they're here to make banking easy and convenient, serving Rome, Blairsville, and Dawsonville. When it comes to meeting your financial needs, they won't settle for anything less than exceptional. To learn more, visit rivercity.bank. So we appreciate River City Bank bringing us the second inning in which the Nighthawks added a run to their 6-1 lead thanks to Georgia Blair before the break with a solo home run. Now Denton out there for the third. She starts with Tavina Checo, who walked and scored the only run today for the Bobcats back in the first. Checo takes strike two on the inside corner. Perfect pitch from Tybee Denton.
I think with the senior day festivities, kind of gets lost a little bit is, you know, the series is still on the line here in this game three for both of these squads. You know, Georgia College trying to hand North Georgia their first PBC series loss this season and their first loss in a game three of a PBC series this season as well.
So 2-2 on Checo, hitting .315 this season. But yeah, you're absolutely right, Robert, is kind of lost in the shuffle of today, is the fact that the Nighthawks were three outs away on Wednesday from Alabama-Huntsville being just the fifth team since UNG won the national championship in 2015 to take two wins in Dahlonega. It's only happened four times since then. Georgia College, behind 6-1 here in the third, still has that opportunity today.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, we saw in that game two, North Georgia, you know, the final score, they, you know, won rather comfortably, but still, Georgia College, every chance that they got, you know, were trying to climb back into that game, and they threatened, you know, to tie that up a couple of times yesterday. North Georgia was able to prevail, and, you know, setting up a great series finale between these two squads. Score may say 6-1, but you know, I doubt that's what it's going to say come, you know, seventh inning.
And for those that remember yesterday, in the last of the seventh, as Checo puts it softly out into center, just kept carrying Mallory Parker long run to the warning track to make the catch. How about the play from the senior center fielder?
Another example of the consistency on this North Georgia squad. And any ball that comes Mallory Parker's way, she's going to make a play on it. And a great effort there back at the wall to make the catch.
Did not have a loud sound or a lot of exit velocity, but ball just kept going, and so did Mallory to make the grab, as that brings up Carly Gutierrez. Gutierrez out into center field. Parker still going back. This time she runs out of room as Carly Gutierrez hits her third home run this series. Makes it a 6-2 ball game.
I know that we keep bringing her up, but she's just been fantastic in this series for GCSU. Would be shocked to see her not come away with, you know, not just freshman of the week, but again, player of the week.
Yeah, I don't know what else happened around the league. And obviously, you think with seven RBIs and two home runs against the number two team in the country in one game, we mentioned it yesterday, she's obviously a favorite, but that one right there, no matter what anyone else did, might have just solidified it. Her 11th home run and 56th RBI of the year. So now it's Owens, who faces one ball and one strike with one out and one run already across for GCSU. And just finishing the thought, for those that remember yesterday's game, in the last of the seventh, the Bobcats, despite giving up three runs in the bottom of the sixth to the Nighthawks to add some insurance, had the tying run in the on-deck circle and the heart of the order up. And Tybee Denton did a fantastic job ending that game with a pair of strikeouts to Cam Caldwell and Reina Checo.
Yeah, hits come far and few between with Tybee Denton. Like we said earlier, Georgia College, that's not something that they struggle with this season, and so it's definitely a big matchup here this afternoon between one of the highest strikeout pitchers in the Peach Bowl Conference and the nation and one of the best hitting teams in the country.
2-2 sliced foul and out of play on the first base side. And another full count for Denton. Roped foul down the third baseline this time.
We've been talking about the seniors who have been up to bat here for North Georgia. Tybee Denton, also a senior on this North Georgia squad, and she has potential to finish her career here at North Georgia with the most strikeouts in a career in program history. She's creeping up on that 500 mark, and I believe it's like 516 or 518 is the mark that she has to beat.
Out into center one more time. Parker waves the glove as she lets that one sail over her head. Owens did not get a great run out of the box, and with it bounding off the wall, it's just a long single out into center. And Denton's starting to give up some hard contact in this third.
And they're starting to make Mallory work for it there in center field, too. All these hits from Georgia College have come her way.
Yeah, F8. Home run to center and a single to center. And Owens is going to get a pinch runner. Coming in for her is the freshman from Marietta, Addison Black. Brings Conlin up to the plate. She takes strike one. Swing and a miss for strike two. Conlin already one strikeout today, the only strikeout that Tybee Denton has recorded so far. And that's through on the left side for a base hit. After the first out of the inning, three straight knocks, starting with the home run from Gutierrez. Liam Medina and Mike Davenport both still in the dugout, but the bullpen now getting busy for North Georgia.
Yeah, GCSU starting to rack up the hits here in this top of the third inning, and it's kind of similar to what we saw yesterday from Georgia College, where they're doing a lot of their damage, early with no outs or just one out up on the scoreboard, and they're doing it again this afternoon.
First pitch to Ray DeCecco inside for strike one. DeCecco walked her first time up. And strike two.
And DeCecco and Addison Black, who I believe is still pinch running on second there for Georgia College, both freshmen from Hillgrove High School.
Off the inside of the barrel for a foul ball on the 0-2.
That's, I think, kind of an underrated factor in this Georgia College success. You got some players, even though they may be young, they have a lot of experience together. Like, we just had a couple players playing, coming from the same high school, you know, a couple sisters on this lineup, the DeCecco sisters in this GCSU batting order as well.
Ball one low. Good stop by Blair to hold the runners. Up and in. She says it hit her hand, and she's going to get first base. Ooh, I don't know. I thought from up here that caught the knob of Raina Checo's bat.
You definitely heard it make contact with something.
The contact, the noise, that's what makes me think it hit the knob, is the sound that it made. Either way, it loads the bases. And Davenport out of the dugout and ready to take the ball from Tybee Denton. It'll be Aniston Wright after the pitching change. Bases loaded, jam, only one out so far in the inning when we come back on the Nighthawk Sports Network.
Awesome if you could buy your next vehicle without going to the dealership. Now you can with Beaver Direct. It's fast and really simple. Log into BeaverToyotaCumming.com, click on Beaver Direct, quietly shop from hundreds of vehicles, obtain a credit approval and trade appraisal in minutes.
Northeast Georgia Health System is a proud supporter of North Georgia Nighthawk Athletics.
The road to national championships runs through NCAA.com. And whether you follow one college team or all of them, it's never been easier to get the content you want with NCAA.com, the home of college sports.
So Aniston Wright, the senior pitcher out of Sonoya. Ready to take over in the circle and try to get out of this bases loaded jam. First pitch to Caroline Pollock is outside for ball one.
We mentioned yesterday that Aniston Wright had some huge games for North Georgia towards that end of the regular season after they went through a bit of a slump against Columbus State. It was Aniston Wright who kind of rallied this team a bit, especially in the bullpen, and had some really big games down the stretch for the Nighthawks.
She pitched yesterday in the blowout Game 1 loss for the Nighthawks, and after Kristen Davis and Delaney Heberlin were unsuccessful going against the Bobcats, Aniston Wright didn't allow a base runner after that. And there were only through, I think it was 2.1 innings as that game ended in five. But with how that Bobcat offense was hitting yesterday, to not allow any base runners and get all contact outs was pretty impressive. Blair stops that pitch outside. All runners hold where they are. The 2-2. Swung on and popped up and just getting out of play. So as of right now, Tybee Denton's line reads 2 1/3 innings, 4 hits allowed with only 1 strikeout and 3 walks. She is responsible for the 3 runners currently on base. So that will have an effect on her run total and her ERA once this inning is decided. 2-2 again. Strike 3 called. Pollock watched one go by the wayside right down the middle. And Aniston Wright with a big second out.
Yeah, leave runners stranded on all the bags here. Aniston Wright's able to get out of this inning for North Georgia. That's going to be really, really big.
Oda Martin is grounded to Brumby right at third. She steps on the bag, and Aniston Wright does just that. Work out of a bases-loaded jam and keep the Bobcats low on the scoreboard. 6-2, the Nighthawks looking to add to that in the third, celebrating Senior Day, hopefully with a win here on the Nighthawks Sports Network. So for the first time today, after subbing in defensively at shortstop, Riley Moody, the junior transfer, will get an at-bat here in the bottom of the third. At least a run in each inning so far for the Nighthawks already. Moody hard on the ground, or no, that's through the air and caught by third baseman Reyna Checo right at the bag. One pitch and one out, just like that. Brumby, nobody on in front of her this time after her two-run double in the first. Brumby, another base hit. This one's all the way to the corner and left. Buries by the NCAA logo, and Brumby gets to second. She's 2-for-2 with a pair of doubles today.
She flexes over to the North Georgia dugout. Brumby's been big here for North Georgia in these past handful of games. So that walk-off base hit against Alabama Huntsville in the bottom of the seventh inning in Game 2 on Wednesday, and I think I missed the golden opportunity to say Mary Seal seals the deal. But instead, I said Mary Seal Brumby seals the deal at the end of that game. I was just in a zone in that one. That was just blacked out.
Yeah, that's a blackout moment for sure as a broadcaster. I know in my career I've had a couple of those. And that was a great call on your part, by the
way,
and what was a fantastic walk-off and comeback. And that is one of those moments where it happens, you know it happens, but you have no idea what you said. Simmons back up the middle all the way to the wall in left center field. Brumby scores. Simmons trades places with her. An RBI double again, and it's 7-2 Nighthawks.
That makes the production easy. Had a run up on the board for North Georgia and keep the bases as they are.
Always fun when they just trade places like that. Keep it going. Another good doubles candidate, Mallory Parker, still looking for her first hit today. 0-for-1 with a strikeout, but a walk and a run scored to the first. For those that miss it, head to UNG_Nighthawks on social media to check out what we talked about yesterday. Mallory Parker and her brother, Ren, surprising her coming home from the military, spending time at Arlington National Cemetery as an officer. Surprised her as a part of this celebratory senior weekend. He'll walk with her and her parents today during the post-game senior celebration. Very cool moment. Very cool to see her reaction. And that video and the capture of that moment is on social media if anybody wants to check it out. We highly suggest you do because brings a smile to your face.
Absolutely. Such a wholesome moment, a great moment to capture. And, you know, until you're in person at one of those events, you don't understand the emotion that goes into something like that, not having seen someone for quite some time.
Another base hit out into center. After a sharp line out from Riley Moody that could have easily resulted in a single or even a double, the Nighthawks have gone double, double, sharp, single in the third. And guess who's up again? Georgia Blair with a home run already today.
Yeah, she's got smoke coming off of her bat still, and that's going to cause a meeting in the circle here for the Bobcats.
And I think a change, maybe not. Kenneth Bellamy motioned to the bullpen, and they will go that way. So we'll step aside for another pitching change, this time for the Bobcats here on the Nighthawk Sports Network. Georgia Blair after the pitching change with a home run already today. She's got a pair of runners occupying the corners on in front of her and only one out here in third. Parker quickly down to second base. Her second steal of the day and fifth of the year pretty easily as Gutierrez doesn't even bother to throw down as that pitch was in the dirt. So it's Caitlin Anders, junior out of Maconda, Illinois, way up north in the Midwest. Down here, taking over out of the bullpen. Blair seeing that one all the way into the glove. A good pitch down the middle, and I'm guessing Georgia Blair watched that go by intentionally to maybe time it up. And that might be trouble for Anders.
Yeah, Georgia Blair, like we said, still got smoke coming off that bat. Doesn't swing on that one, though.
That one too low. enters this season, 13 appearances, all of them in relief, less than 13 innings. 2-1 is outside. She's got a 7.74 ERA. She's walked 7 batters and only struck out 1 this year. She's got a tough hitter to face in her first one, and in a tough count, it's 3-1. Blair swings and hits it on the ground foul. She'll see another.
What kind of both of these squads have done so far pitching-wise is they've done a pretty solid job of working their way back into these counts against these North Georgia and these Georgia College batters when North Georgia's in the circle.
3-2 through the left side. More RBIs for Georgia Blair. Simmons scores. Blair's caught in between first and second, and she'll just go back to first. Reyna Checo, pretty smart there. Simmons scores. Parker over to third. Georgia Blair with an RBI knock. Second RBI of the day.
Yeah, seniors on the spotlight this afternoon.
Really surprised to see Reyna Checo hang on to that ball there. I mean, Blair was dead in the middle between first and second base, right at the 30-foot mark. Has taken Laval Masonette, now pinch hitting here for Sophie Mooney. Laval Masonette, the redshirt freshman. But credit to Checo for that decision, because I guarantee you she throws that ball over to first, Mallory Parker tries to dart home.
Oh, absolutely.
Good stop by Gutierrez behind the plate on the pitch inside. Both runners stay. Georgia Blair down to second base without a throw on that last pitch.
We talked about Tegan a bit yesterday. Redshirt freshman has had some big moments stepping up for North Georgia and some injuries into the starting lineup.
Little blooper drops in right center. One run scores as Parker. Blair's right behind her. Laval Masonette with a two-run knock. Right on cue with you, Robert. She's got the earpiece in. She's listening. A little flare in the right center and into no man's land. Laval Masonette gets a couple more RBIs for her season total.
Very reminiscent of game one yesterday, except the script, has been flipped.
So that's now 16 RBIs in total this year. For Tegan, Wicker shows down a bunt, nearly perfect. It just had a little too much backspin as it rolled back into foul territory. They got speed with Wick in the batter's box and Tegan on the bases. And with 5 runs in the first, a lone run in the second, and now 4 here in the third with only 1 out. The Nighthawks need to get 6 more outs now on defense to end this game in 5 and start the Senior Day celebration a little bit early, which will make some people here happy because it's not only Sunday as that one gets away from Gutierrez. Laval Masonette, a hard turn at second as she moves on the pass ball. Not only Sunday, Robert, but I think you know what I'm about to say next.
Oh, man.
It's a very important Sunday. And for some particular fans, it's the most important Sunday of the year.
Oh, I'm just drawing a blank.
We talked about it yesterday. I tried to set you up here, man.
Oh, man. I'm folding right now. I am just folding right now. I am completely drawing a blank.
It's not only Sunday today. It is Masters Sunday.
That's right. I forgot. We did talk about that at the end of game one.
I gotta say, I love you, man, but that one's on you. I thought you were gonna be on top of that.
With Masters, in the Peach State too. That's
absolutely, man.
You know, I'll take the heat for that one.
the leaders, Scotty Scheffler and Colin Morikawa, teeing off in about 15 minutes here. Not too far down in Augusta. The 3-1 on Wicker, swing and a miss. Makes it 3 balls and 2 strikes.
It's hard to shift your focus to the pros and the Masters when you got, you know, two nationally ranked teams here at North Georgia, men's and women's golf, kind of taking up
right,
a lot of attention.
Exactly, exactly. That's the golf that we're really concerned about. Wicker skies it foul the other way, out of play.
It's interesting. That foul ball went into the direction of Bob Stein Stadium just to the left of us. And you know, sometimes when we have baseball and softball going on simultaneously here at Lynn Cottrell Park, it can make for some interesting plays. Sometimes
yeah.
You see some baseballs roll onto the hill. Sometimes a softball into the Steiner.
Wicker to short. Laval Maisonette just gets back on the line out. So Gracie Mixon will get to bat and has taken a void of the double play. I feel like it's more likely that a softball gets to the, and more common, that a softball gets to the baseball stadium than the inverse, because there is a tall net blocking from what is Bob Stein Stadium's right field wall. Now, some home runs probably go directly into this net, but you'd have to power it from over there to get it onto the softball field. And it's most likely that that's coming from a lefty, which is less common than right-handed batters. I've got the math figured out, everybody. Don't worry. It's more common the softball goes to the baseball field than the other way around. Mixon showing bunt. Gets away from Gutierrez. And Laval Maisonette over to third. She's advanced 120 feet on the bases on pass balls alone. That one might go in as a wild pitch. I think the first one was a pass ball, though. So 2-0 on Mixon, who's walked twice today already. Delayed strike calls today from our home plate umpire. And on those pitches that are close, it's always hard to tell.
Just adding to a bit of suspense here.
He's adding to how much longer the golf fans here have to wait to go watch Masters Sunday. That's what he's doing. Mixon out into right. Martin in and now back. She makes the catch. And finally, the third out is recorded by the Bobcats, but not before the Nighthawks get four. They now lead by eight, and they need just six more outs to end this game and this series and celebrate Senior Sunday here in the Nighthawk Sports Network. Brian Properties is a commercial real estate brokerage firm serving Northeast Georgia and is presenting today's fourth inning. Located in nearby Cumming, Brian Properties specializes in commercial real estate along the Georgia 400 corridor. For more information on Brian Properties, visit brianproperties.net. So Nighthawks now up by eight in play for the run rule. Only six outs left to get. Aniston Wright, who came on last inning in the top of the third, and promptly got out of it with a strikeout and a ground out to Mackenzie Martin. So she starts with a 9-1-2 in the fourth. Eliza Kuhn, the first of that. And the first pitch ball to said Kuhn, the center fielder.
And if Aniston Wright is able to close out this game for North Georgia, it'll be great to see, you know, a handful of seniors on this North Georgia roster picking up some highlights this afternoon.
Absolutely. Taking a look at the batting lineup, every senior position player has scored at least a run today and has reached base, obviously, at least once. As Kuhn on the unassisted ground out to Mary Seal Brumby, who's had a big day at the plate. couple unassisted groundouts as well. That's actually the second time Kuhn's done that today, and that's how the last inning ended. Brumby busy on both sides of the diamond. Hobbs swings at the first pitch, and Simmons only has to move a few steps in before she makes the catch.
And Brumby's play at first is going to be huge for North Georgia, especially, you know, Sophie Mooney, who, you know, has occupied that spot for a little while for North Georgia. She's one of those utility players where, you know, she sometimes serves as the designated player up to bat. Sometimes she's in the circle, does some pitching for North Georgia. And if she's able to, you know, kind of limit herself to just pitching and just hitting while Brumby is holding it down strong at first base, that's going to be a huge advantage for North Georgia.
So it's 0-1 on Davina Checo, who is 0-for-1 today. Walked and scored in the first, and that's it. That one's through. She's got her first knock of the day on the right side. And first hit or base runner allowed by Aniston Wright. Carly Gutierrez, a home run last time. Now she's got a runner on in front of her. She's got a chance to avoid the run rule for the Bobcats. She'll just put a flare out into right, trying to go for three. And doing so successfully is Davina Checo.
And that ball got to Gracie Mixon in time. She just had to take a couple steps back. The softball bounced in front of her. That's going to put runners on the corners here.
And Jessica Owens has re-entered after being pinch run for last inning. Gutierrez, a hit now in all three games this series. Obviously three in game one yesterday, including a pair of home runs. The third was a double. Her one hit in game two was a double. And she's got a home run and a single today. Inside. Ball one to Owens. Robert, you mentioned the baseball field in Bob Stein Stadium. We do have an update from St. Augustine, Florida. The Nighthawks salvage game three of the series against Flagler with a 3-1 win. That's through the left side on the ground. An RBI knock for Owens. Gutierrez going to third. The throw in time, but again, just like the last one that you mentioned, Robert, a little off the base. And now the Bobcats within seven. Corners stay occupied in the fourth.
Yeah, GCSU, they are, like we saw in game two, not going to go down without a fight. It's very rare that you see ground outs from GCSU or pop flies and routine plays for the outfield. They're going to make you work for it, and they're doing so here in this top of the fourth.
So Cam Caldwell, like we've seen in each of the first two games, getting late pinch hit opportunities, their best hitter. And I think we have concluded at this point that Cam Caldwell is probably not 100% healthy, but healthy enough to go out there and swing, and she lines it right to Riley Moody at short. A good swing for Caldwell. The Bobcats get a run. It's 10-3. Nighthawks batting in the fourth. After these words on your home for UNG softball, the Nighthawk Sports Network.
My name is Lana Titterina, and UNG is where I lead. I chose UNG because of the tennis program and how much the tennis program has achieved in the past. And I wanted to be a part of building a good team. But also the campus is very beautiful, the location. It has the new business building that I really like. And when I did my research, I really liked Dahlonega in Georgia. So one of the biggest challenges that I faced was coming here and not knowing anyone. I didn't know how the culture was and how to really approach people. And being new and not knowing anyone can be tough in the beginning. So you have to really put yourself out there and make connections, talk to people. So that's where I feel like I've grown a lot and I've gotten to know a lot of people here, and that has helped my experience My advice for international students would be just go for it. It may be tough in the beginning, but it's all going to be worth it at the end. You're going to meet amazing people. It's really fun, and you get a very good degree.
Aniston Wright is going to bat now here in the fourth as she gets re-entered into the lineup after taking over in the circle. So I don't envy our student worker Jack Orr today on the stats having to input some of the substitutions, right? Starts in the lineup as the DP, then comes out, and Katie Ward takes her spot. And the DP switched a couple of different players. Then she comes back in the circle to try to get some outs. And now, because of that, and the DP spot taken up, right now batting.
If anybody can handle all those subs, though, it's one of the best statters in Division II, Jack Orr.
He has got it on lock. Has been great for us all year long. Wright did bat in the first, in that 11-batter first inning. Was hit by a pitch and reached all the way to third before the inning ended. This inning, she's got Kelsey Parler, a freshman pitcher out of Hazelhurst. And she skies it to the right side. Coming in is Martin, who makes the catch.
Number 27, Riley Moody.
Strike one to Moody.
Moody's an example of how Coach Davenport's been able to kind of seamlessly add some new pieces into this lineup. Senior last year, Matty Perry held down that shortstop position for quite a few years, graduated, and Moody has fit in really nice here with North Georgia.
No balls, two strikes. Moody's first at bat this game was last inning on that sharp line out to third base. Up way above the zone from Parler. Parler this year, 17-plus innings. She did make a start in her 12 appearances, an ERA just inside a 9. For the first-year Bobcat, 2 balls and 2 strikes.
Tell you what, Sol, GCSU going to the bullpen. Was hoping we could see Golden Thrower just for the name alone.
She threw yesterday, and we got to see her for a little bit, but we really didn't get to talk about that. How good is it? A pitcher named Golden Thrower.
It just couldn't be more perfect.
Moody out into center, and her second line out of the day. Another good swing for the shortstop. Sometimes good swings don't mean base knocks.
Can't win them all.
Marysville Brumby's had a good day, a couple of good swings, and a couple of base knocks. 2 doubles, 2 RBIs as well. Should she get on, the lineup will flip back over to Madison Simmons at the top. Brumby takes ball one. Parler delivers the 1-0. Brumby takes it on the outside edge for a strike. So next for the Nighthawks is a 3-game road series at Lander. The doubleheader on Saturday starts at 12. Sunday's final game, which is likely senior day for the Bearcats, also at 12 noon on April 21st. Then just 5 days after that, right here in Dahlonega, the PBC tournament starts with the quarterfinals on April 26th, Friday, a double elimination tournament. Rumby pops it fouling out of play.
I believe we have some shakeups in the PBC standings as well. Columbus State no longer second in the conference. Now Lander, the 14-7 record in conference play. It's going to make things interesting to see who's going to be that number two seed and host that second half of the tournament.
Tell you what, Lander on the diamond, both softball and baseball, doing impressive things at the end of this season. The Bearcats on the softball diamond have won five straight, including three over Georgia Southwestern and two over Flagler. Over in baseball, they've been third place behind Georgia College and North Georgia all season long, the two teams that you see today, but in baseball. And just this past week, the Bearcats swept the Bobcats of Georgia College to leap all the way to first in the baseball standings. That means a lot for the Nighthawks because the top two seeds in the Peach Belt tournament host the first round of the conference tournament. And now the Nighthawks with a three-game series coming up after losing the series to Flagler. They've got three against Georgia College coming up here at home to end the regular season next weekend. And that could decide whether they're going to be likely the second seed hosting any part of the PBC tournament.
Yeah, it's going to be a huge series at home. And for North Georgia, it's going to be at home here at Bob Stein Stadium, where they've been great all season long. And so we should be in for a fun finish to the regular season.
Brumby on the ground and another knock as it squirts off the glove of Davina Checo and into center field. See what they go up with on the scoreboard, whether that's Brumby's third base hit of the day or an error. I could see that being ruled an error.
I think they added hit number eight up on the board for North Georgia.
I've got eight hits total before this inning started, but I could be wrong. You might be right. The scoreboard still has not updated, so it's a knock for Brumby, her third of the day. She is 3-for-3.
With all the seniors graduating on this North Georgia squad, Brumby looks like she's going to hold down that third base position for North Georgia for years to come.
Yeah, it's hard not to look at some of, on senior day, still not look at some of the underclassmen on this team. Katie Ward, Riley Moody's likely going to be back next year despite not being an underclassman. Mary Seal Brumby, she takes off. What a great eye by Brumby. Seeing that pitch out of the hand, that was wild, and she gets to second base easily. Simmons sharply through the left side. Brumby's getting the wave from Davenport. Here comes the throw. There is no throw. Cut off at third. Brumby slides in safely. Nighthawks back up by eight.
That's exactly what they needed here in this bottom of the fourth inning. Puts them up at that, you know, the magic number, eight runs here. This bottom of the fourth inning could potentially close things out in the top of the fifth.
Madison Simmons with a pair of knocks, an RBI attached to both of them today. She's had a good day. Looks like Davenport, after the first pitch, quickly to Mallory Parker, is now going to get a pinch runner for Simmons over there at first base. And popping out of the dugout is Caitlin Johnson, the freshman from Monroe. Saw her a little bit yesterday as part of those substitutions that Davenport did, tinkering with the lineup to try to find anything that would be successful in game number two. And Johnson had a decent day.
I saw her do some pinch hitting as well.
So they did actually change that to an error on the scoreboard. So Mary Seal Brumby, 2-for-2 today, reaching on the error with two outs here in the fourth. Nine hits for the Nighthawks on 11 runs. Swing and a miss. Throw down to second as Johnson was running. Not a dime. Slides under the tag. It is 1-2 on Parker.
And this is indicative of what we've seen from North Georgia all season long, where you get on base with one of those highest on base percentages in the country, get a stolen base, and a double to send him home.
Swing and a miss. Parker strikes out, second time today for her. But the Nighthawks back up by 8 runs. It's 11-3, and it's the last chance for Georgia College to get back on the board in the top of the fifth on the Nighthawk Sports Network.
I need to try it first.
NCAA and its member schools offer nearly 500,000 college athletes a path to go pro in something other than sports. Learn more at NCAA.org.
Aniston Wright looking to end this game for the Nighthawks. She did allow a run last inning. After coming in for Tybee Denton in the third. So she's got Raina Checo, Caroline Pollock, Mackenzie Martin, barring any substitutions.
Still a big inning here for North Georgia. Like we said earlier, GCSU, they are not going to go down without a fight. Expect to see some base runners here at some point for the Bobcats to see if the Nighthawks can take care of them.
Again, with the 8-run advantage, a run at least in every inning for the Nighthawks today. This game could end with 3 outs if no runners come across. Out in the left and caught. Nice play by Caitlin Johnson ranging back into her right. Raina Checo disgusted at what was a good swing, and again, not rewarded. Sometimes it's just the way it goes in this game.
I think that also shows the versatility of this North Georgia roster. We've seen a handful of players in this game play left field for North Georgia. Johnson, I believe the third player out there in left already, second or third for Coach Davenport, and hasn't mattered. They've all been making plays.
This one's also out into left, and Johnson calling everybody off. Quickly, just like that, the freshman makes a couple outs, and GCSU is down to their last out. So with Johnson pinch running for Simmons last inning, she takes over in left. Simmons out of the game now. Wicker, who was in left, has moved over to right. The infield has not shifted since the last time we spoke, other than Tegan LaValle Masonette now in at second base after her pinch hit at bat. That's been that way for 2 innings now, though. I think we just missed it last inning. The 0-1 from right skips in to Mackenzie Martin, who is 0-2 today. All the hitting came from the usual suspects today for Georgia College. They've got 7 hits and 3 runs, 1 error thus far in this game. Off the glove of right, tough play for LaValle Masonette, and she won't make it as Martin beats it out on an infield single. But before that hit from Mackenzie Martin, nobody below the 5 hole had a base knock today. All 7 hits came from the 2, 3, 4, and 5 hitters. That's Checo, Gutierrez, Owens, and Conlin. couple walks, one from Raina Checo, one from Caroline Pollock. Raina was also hit by a pitch. But no hits in hitters 6, 7, 8, 9, and 1.
And we mentioned this yesterday a bit, too. It's been incredibly impressive in this series for Georgia College to, you know, see the success that they have without having Cam Caldwell for most of this series.
Caldwell did get a pinch hit appearance and sharply lined out to short in just a few pitches. That was for Stephanie Conlin last inning. Eliza Kuhn, the center fielder, in a 1-1. 0 for 2 today, both ground outs to Mary Seal Brumby at first. Wright rubs the ball on her hip and now fires. Outside, good stop by Blair. So Blair's conversation with Wright is done, and we're ready to go for the 2-1. We gave you the update on baseball. We do not have an update, but we can tell you that men's and women's tennis played today just not too far down in Atlanta against Emory University. Women are having a historic season, number 3 in the nation right now. Angelina Linikova climbed up as high as number 7, which is the highest individual women's singles ranking in program history. She's now number 9. But they're 18-0, longest win streak in program history. If they end the season undefeated, it'll be 22-0, which will be, I think, tied for the most wins in program history before postseason play. The 3-1 is taken all the way by Kuhn, and she takes a strike.
Yeah, what the women's tennis team has done this season is just a representation of all the success that we've seen across all of UNG athletics this year. Lots of our teams, you know, doing stuff that no previous North Georgia teams have done before.
Men's tennis, number 10 in the country. They're 10-5 on the year. Kuhn, first base side. I was going to say, there's no way that ball is an unassisted ground out to Mary Silbrumby again to end the game. That would be kind of fitting, though, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would have been her third of the game.
Yep. So, Georgia College's fate in this game rests on the 3-2 with two down here in the top of the fifth. The run to avoid the mercy rule stands at first. Here it is. Swing and a miss. Aniston Wright ends it with a strikeout, and the Nighthawks end senior day with just a very, very fun win. A thrilling game. A lot of offense, some good defense. They win the series 11-3. In game 3 against the Bobcats. Robert, today was a lot of fun.
Oh, absolutely. Getting to see our seniors in action today. And it was, you know, the veterans on this team that stepped up here in this series finale. Madison Simmons, 2-for-3. Georgia Blair, 2-for-3 as well. A couple RBIs. Sophie Mooney only had that one hit, but it was on a couple pitches she saw. Slam one out of here for a 3-run bomb. And so it was great to see the seniors here in their final game of the regular season at home shine here for North Georgia.
So the Nighthawks win it. They will now head on the road to Lander for a 3-game series to end the regular season in the Peach Belt, a regular season which they have already been named champions. Now 41-7 on the year, 19-2 in conference, and a whopping 24-5 home record is how the 2024 season concludes. Home record for now, regular season home record. There's postseason play scheduled here in Dahlonega, not just in the PBC, but hopefully in the NCAA Southeast Regional Tournament. We hope to bring all of that to you here on the Nighthawk Sports Network. For the softball regular season, we say goodbye. We say thank you for joining us. For my broadcast partner and producer today, Robert D. Clemente, I am Brennan Shabath. Glad you could be here. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday. We're going to go celebrate the seniors here for the 2024 Nighthawks softball program. Nighthawks win 11-3 over the Bobcats. Enjoy your evening, everyone.